Welcome to Green and Red, scrappy politics for scrappy people, a regular podcast on radical, environmental and anti-capitalist politics, brought to you by Bob Bazanko and Scott Parker.
Welcome to the silky smooth sounds of the Green and Red podcast. I'm your co-host, Scott Parkin, in Berkeley, California. And as always, I am joined by
Bob Bazanko in Houston, Texas, and looking forward to talking to one of our best friends today.
Yep. And today we're going to be joined by Professor Clinton Fernandes. Professor Fernandes holds dual appointments at the School of Humanities and Social Sciences and the Australian Center for Cybersecurity at the University of New South Wales in Canberra. He has published on the relationship between science, diplomacy, and international law, intelligence operations and foreign policy, the political and regulatory implications of new technology and Australia's external relations, just generally. He is a former Australian Army officer who served in the Australian Army Corps, and he is the author of Island Off the Coast of Asia, Instruments of Statecraft in Australian Foreign Policy. And we'll be talking to him in a few minutes, and we'll be right back. All right, folks, we are back with Professor Clinton Fernandes. We're going to be talking about Russia and Ukraine and the wider meanings of what's going on in the world. Welcome back to Green and Red, Clinton.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, we're very excited to be talking to you. We've been getting ready for this all week. In your book, which came out in 2019 with Uncle Sam Wants, you used a number of WikiLeaks documents to, do a review of U.S. foreign policy. And then you have a chapter actually dedicated to NATO, Georgia, Russia, Ukraine. And I'm wondering if you could just like talk a little bit about that, what compelled you to write the chapter and more questions.
Well, the book itself is based on reading approximately 8 million words of State Department cables, which were released by WikiLeaks. And those cables cover the first decade of this century. In a sense, they are a window into a world in transition, because it was the decade between the worst period of economic privation of the former Soviet Union, the Yeltsin government, the time before Vladimir Putin became significant. And then the decade leading up to the global financial crisis and the early part of its fallout. And so whatever happens after that is what people tend to focus on, like the events in Ukraine in the Maidan events of 2014, the seizure of Crimea. Those are the publicly known aspects of the issue. But what the State Department cables do is provide you with a decade-long explanation of what led up to that. And what led up to that, in two words, can be called strategic empathy, or the lack of it. It's not about feeling empathetic towards the personality of whoever happens to be the president of Russia, but rather to understand, as conservative realists in international relations do, that one has to have strategic empathy, that you want to make sure that you're not conducting yourself in a way that puts the other side in a position where they have to take aggressive action against you. And what the leaked cables, the cables that WikiLeaks released showed, was that there was no strategic empathy. That the crisis that we see today actually begins in the 1990s, when there was a vision provided by Gorbachev for a common European homeland, that there would be one European homeland with multiple poles from Lisbon to Vladivostok, and that it wouldn't simply be subordinated to the Atlantic Alliance of NATO. So a European homeland and European security could be done between the whole of Eurasia, which includes Russia, but without it being subordinated to the Atlantic Alliance. And this was the proposals that were made at Malta in 1989, as well as the fall of the Soviet Union in 1991. But they were pushed aside because as far as the United States was concerned, Russia had not just collapsed and lost the Cold War, but it was basically going to do the US's bidding. And historically, that's just not the way Russia would see itself. It would see itself as mauled, as weak, as wounded, but it would still remain in its own mind a great power. And in a practical sense, given its formidable natural resources and its antiquated but still formidable nuclear weapons program, it would always have enough deterrence to not have to be subordinated to anybody else. But what the cables show, and they correspond to things that have been written as well, mostly in the business press and elsewhere, is that the idea of a common European homeland always took a back seat to NATO. The idea was that NATO expansion would provide the United States with a way to incorporate the whole of Europe, including the former Warsaw Pact countries, into a capitalist economy that was dominated by the interests of private investors, and many of those private investors would be from the United States. And this begins, in fact, in May 1999. The roots of our current geopolitical tensions, not just with Russia, but with China, actually begin in May 1999 with the bombing of the Chinese embassy in Belgrade during the Yugoslav War. The most authoritative insider account of all this comes from a man called John Norris, who wrote a book called Collision Course. And that explains how he, as the Deputy White House Chief of Communications, saw the Kosovo and Serbia wars of the 1990s. The foreword to that book, Collision Course, was written by Strobe Talbot, who was Bill Clinton's Undersecretary of State that became ambassador. He was a roommate of Bill Clinton when they were both Rhodes Scholars together. So we're talking about people who are very, very much insiders. And he writes a foreword to this book by John Norris, who was actually working for him as the communications chief at the deputy chief of communications at the White House in Clinton's administration. And he says that what explains the war in Kosovo was not the fate of the Kosovo Albanians, but rather the failure of Yugoslavia under Milosevic to get with the broader themes of economic liberalization and integration into the European economic system. Okay. China took from that the idea that the United States was conducting an aggressive war because it was not authorized by the United Nations Security Council, but they were still able to attack what had been a sovereign state, Yugoslavia. And even after Serbia and Slovenia and Bosnia-Herzegovina had moved on, attacked the further rump of that state, Yugoslavia, Serbia, and taken off a part of it, Kosovo, and they were now going to call it independent. And this was regarded by China and, of course, by Russia at the time as totally against the ideas of the United Nations Charter. China began to realize that, well, the United States probably sees itself as the next head on the block, on the chopping block. Nothing actually happened because the United States decided that it was going to invade Iraq and so on. But the problem, as far as Russia was concerned, this comes out from the cables, is that NATO seems to be expanding its forces right up to our borders in violation to an undertaking given that they would not expand 1 inch to the east of East Germany, let alone come all the way from Germany all the way into Eastern Europe. And the key issue becomes, where should NATO's missiles be placed? When we say NATO, we generally mean the United States. We're not talking about Portugal's missiles, for example. And so where should NATO's missiles be placed? The core aspect of having no strategic empathy is that you say we have to plan for other countries' capabilities. We can't really be fooled by their intentions. We can't place too much emphasis on their intentions. We have to consider their capabilities. But other countries must consider our intentions, not our capabilities. and our intentions are benign and benevolent. And so it doesn't matter that we are putting missiles right on your border. Why don't you believe our benign intentions? And so we want other countries to accept our intentions, but we plan for capabilities. And that basically is a kind of imperial mentality, which shows that you don't have strategic empathy.
Yeah.
The war in Georgia, sorry, go on.
Well, but Putin took much the same lesson out of Kosovo, that, you know, the United States wasn't really going to accept any kind of rules-based order. Putin apparently, you know, actually believed that they would abide by international law. And so he realized that if the United States was going to do this, much like the Chinese realized, then, you know, like the old Soviet Union, they were going to be encircled by hostile forces. And as I always point out, you know, because here in the United States, I've talked to you before about NATO liberals. To talk about this makes one pro-Putin. And one of the reasons I really wanted to talk to you also was because you did the, you know, real research in it. You looked at the WikiLeaks tables. I've looked at nowhere near what you have in them. And what's really striking is these aren't coming from political scientists. This isn't Mearsheimer. This isn't an old quote from Kennan. This is from, you know, people like Burns, who was both an ambassador to Russia and
yes,
deputy secretary of state. And so I think that's really critical to kind of, because here in the United States, you know, and I don't know how much, you know, we've talked before about how crazy the US is. I mean, you know, we really are being accused of being like Putin apologists, you know, because we talk about things like NATO in the same way that George Frost Cannon or even, you know, Henry Kissinger did. And so I think those WikiLeaks cables are really instrumental in that.
And, yeah, I mean, it's you know, basically it's, the authors. It's from their own, it's their own
yeah, words, right? I think it's also striking that NATO liberals are probably the most rabid about Julian Assange too. I mean, they would put this guy in a cage with hyenas if they could. So this is their commitment to free expression. But
the claim about pro-Putin and things like that is basically just discursive chewing gum. It's not really something that one can affect. You can't rebut it, really. I mean, what are you going to say? I'm not a pro-Putin guy. You can just say that forever, and then you wind up talking the issue, but about what you are not. And so you just sort of let people chew on their, you know, on their chewing gum, and if they're ready to talk about something substantive, then you can engage.
I think it's important. You're an internationally recognized scholar who's done like really interesting and important primary work in this. And so hearing this from you, you know, I think, you know, Scott and I have been saying this, but we're just two American lefties who are apparently pro-Putin, you know, and we quit drinking vodka even. It doesn't seem to help. So, you know.
Well, I'd like to sort of address this issue about what you said about the rules-based international order.
Yeah.
I think it's important to take very seriously the United States' utterances about the rules-based international order being their guiding principle. It's just that it's got nothing to do with international law. The rules-based international order is an imperial order, which has three components. The first component is what you just said, which is the belief in imperial benevolence, that our intentions, no matter what we're doing, our intentions are always benign and high-minded and sincere. That's the first aspect of a rules-based order. The second aspect is the economic doctrine of comparative advantage, that other countries which are, you know, which have got lots of wheat or critical minerals or anything else, they have to make their resources available to private investors in the manner desired by private investors. Now, it's not just American investors, but the United States, its corporations are the largest in the world. And so those private investors would benefit more than anybody else, you know, disproportionately. But the idea is to make the resources of any country available to the private sector and private investors in the manner desired by them. That's comparative advantage. Rather than, for example, saying, no, we're going to develop our own manufacturing here. We are going to invite people to come over, and if they would like to use our resources, then they can give us the technology, and we can do technology transfer, so we can then develop. Now, that's why China is actually criticized for not being a responsible stakeholder in the system, to borrow Robert Zoellick's phrase, the United States Trade Representative. And that's because they are telling foreign companies, you can come here, and we'll assemble things for you at low cost, with it because our labor is cheap. But after a period of time, we want to know your technology so we can start making it too. And that way, we are not simply an assembly area for it, but that violates the doctrine of comparative advantage. The doctrine of comparative advantage is the fundamental doctrine of empire. And it was offered, that advice was offered by Adam Smith to the Americans in the 18th century. And he said that what you should be doing is remaining an agricultural society, and that'll lead your country to true greatness because the manufacturing should be done in Britain. But the primary crops and the raw material should be grown in the United States. Now, it's because the United States rejected this advice from the preeminent economist of his era that they were able to develop into an industrial superpower. Alexander Hamilton's Report of Manufacturers, for example, was a rejection of the doctrine of comparative advantage. It was a protectionist doctrine, which is against the idea of an open, smaller, liberal international economy. And so that's the second pillar of empire. The third pillar of empire is the necessity of projecting force all the way across to the borders of the other country. The United States is the only country in the world whose military is designed to leave its hemisphere, not just its borders, its hemisphere, cross vast oceans on either side, and then conduct major hostilities on the territory of other countries. And therefore, the need to preserve Taiwan as what Douglas MacArthur called an unsinkable aircraft carrier, because it allows a force to be projected right up to the border of the eastern part of the Eurasian continent, and NATO allows it to project power all the way to the western part of the Eurasian continent. And so this ensures that Russia effectively will have only one all-year port, that's a warm water port, which is the Crimean Peninsula's port of Sevastopol. And there is a second port they have, which is in the Mediterranean, it's Latakia, which is a Syria's port. And both of those ports are actually enclosed by land masses controlled by NATO. So the Black Sea, for example, is controlled by, access to the Black Sea is controlled not just by Turkey, but by Spain on the other side of the Mediterranean Sea. And access to Latakia in Syria is also controlled by NATO allies. On the northern side in the North Sea, Russian forces, the naval forces, have to cross a patrol line patrolled by submarines between Iceland and Norway. And if they try and get out into the North Atlantic, they've got to get through other NATO allies and the Skagerrak, which is the sea that's in the near Arctic areas. And so the idea is to keep Russia and China corralled as continental powers rather than be naval powers. And that's basically what the point of what the third pillar of a rules-based order is. So I, when you say that Putin thought we were going to have a rules-based order, well, actually, we are having a rules-based order. It's just that it's got nothing to do with international law. A rules-based order is a euphemism for empire. That cannot be said explicitly. Not to others, perhaps not even to oneself. It's no surprise at all to find that those who run an imperial system can't say to themselves that's what they're doing. They have to say that their intentions are benign, that it's really all defensive, that they react defensively to the challenges of the world rather than impose their will on the world. But underpinning it all is the doctrine of comparative advantage. So that's basically where it's at. Now, as for Russia's issues and what the WikiLeaks cables show, I think what it shows, firstly, is the United States' insistence on placing what they call missile defense systems right on the border with Russia, very close to the border with Russia. Now, here's the problem with missile defense systems. A missile defense system can't stop an adversary's first strike, because an adversary that decides to launch first can do so without any warning time, and it has the initiative. So a missile defense system can't stop an adversary's first strike, but once the adversary strikes, you can retaliate and your missile defense system can stop their second strike, right? And by stopping the adversary's second strike, it gives an advantage to yourself if you want to strike first. So if you decide to launch first and you've got your missile systems, defense systems up, it means the other side can't retaliate. You see? So the missile defense system isn't really designed to protect yourself against the other side's first strike, but rather if you decide to strike first, it's designed to protect you against their second strike in retaliation against your own. And so it gives an advantage to whoever strikes first. And therefore, in strategic studies, a missile defense system is considered part of an enhanced first strike system. That's the whole issue. And so a missile defense system destabilizes a nuclear balance. Because you don't know what exactly is on the warhead. The missile, the missiles that are launched, that are placed, you know, whether they're placed in Poland or anywhere else, these are American missiles that are placed in Poland or anywhere else. Ostensibly, they are there to shoot down an outgoing Russian missile, but they are shooting it down with a missile of their own, which means they actually have the ability to launch as well. And you don't know. The Russians have no way of knowing. Well, what's on the warhead? Is it a conventional warhead or is it nuclear? And so if the Russians are required to do what we do, which is plan for the adversary's capabilities, not their intentions, then they have to plan for the capability that that the missile that's coming at them could be nuclear. And this is just catastrophic in terms of what the potential consequences could be. And the key meeting occurs in April 2007 at a high-level talk on talks on strategic security, and missile defense dominates that whole thing, right? And it comes in the wake of the Russo-Georgian War of 2008, Declaration of Independence for Kosovo, which had been severed from Serbia without any Security Council resolutions, the invasion of Iraq in 2003, also outside international law, but within the concept of a rules-based international order. I mean, I'm not presenting this as caricature or irony. I actually take it very seriously when the United States or Australia says that we uphold the rules-based international order, because the people who do that are also invading Iraq or placing missiles on another country's borders. And that is their understanding of the rules-based international order. The United States must have the right to intimidate and project power all the way up to another country's borders, because after all, its intentions are benign. And rather than go into the details of what missile was placed where, because to a certain extent, these things have now been overtaken by advancing technology. The core issue here is that if you're trying to stop Russian missiles, there's more than one way to do it than to place ballistic missile defense systems right on their border. Another way is what's called NTMs, National Technical Measures, meaning a treaty which allows you and them to do surveillance on each other for verification, so that you can reduce the number of missiles that you have and verify that that's the case. The other aspect is actually not disarmament. That's a long-term goal, it realistically, but rather disassemblement. You can actually separate the missile and the warhead from each other and make it so there's a greater time needed even to assemble them before you can become threatening. And that's not an original proposal, by the way. It's been proposed by Michael O'Hanlon from the Brookings Institution. That you could actually dismantle them without disarming them. That way you still possess the capability, but then people have breathing space within which to talk. And that's never occurred because the rules-based international order is an imperial one. And it means that you can place your missiles right on the border. Now, the cables basically show that the Russian Ministry of Defense gave a PowerPoint presentation with a detailed technical analysis showing that all this was possible, and the serious danger they feared from NATO missiles very close to their border. But they never paid attention to this. In the end, President Obama decided to discontinue the program for other reasons. But the fundamental point about another country having legitimate defense concerns was ignored.
Well, and Putin had made it clear after the Bucharest meeting in 2008, I believe he said it would be a hostile act. I think those were the words he used to bring Ukraine into NATO. So
I mean, That's right. I mean, and of course, the other thing is that the missile defense system is actually the thin edge of the wedge, right? Once the missile defense system is allowed in there on Russia's borders, well, missile defense, like any technology, is evolving, and its components are evolving. And so this alters the balance of power, because it means that if you have interceptors in Poland that are designed to catch Russian missiles, these interceptors can then be replaced with hypersonic versions of the same interceptors, which can then attack Russia in a way that they really have no time to respond. If you've only got 10 minutes between detecting a launch and the missiles attacking you, and you've got no way to tell if the missiles are carrying a conventional or a nuclear warhead, and you've got 10 minutes to make a decision, it means you're not actually making a decision, because it's already been wargamed. The playbook comes out. When the playbook comes out, it means that whoever is the watch officer at the geopolitical watch desk that runs 24 hours, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, both countries, in fact, most industrial powers have these defense systems where there's somebody on duty at any given point of the day. If a missile launch is detected and you've got 10 minutes, by the time you have to alert the president or whoever else, it's too late, right? So the decision on how to respond has already been fed into and is wired into the response protocols of the 24-hour desk officer's duties. So then that means that basically the human in the loop is effectively taken out. And what if it's a false detection? Because what Russia does not have is over the horizon missile detection systems, early warning systems. The United States has more advanced systems. They call Aegis, A-E-G-I-S, the Aegis system. And these are even located on ships. The Russians do not have ship-mounted versions of Aegis. They don't have the ability to detect things that far away from home. They can only detect incoming ballistic missiles from detection points and sensors that are on their land territory. So they have an even shorter detection time than the United States or than Japan, which or Australia, which has already wargamed Aegis and ballistic missile defense as part of an integrated defense system. Russia doesn't have that. They don't have the technology to detect incoming ballistic missiles from ship-mounted early warning systems. They've only got land-mounted early warning systems, which means they really only have less than 10 minutes between knowing a launch is coming and the launch and the missile landing on their territory. So the decision process of how to respond, these things have already been automated and fed into the playbook. Furthermore, you know from the way the two countries' economies work that the United States is far more technologically advanced. Whether it's the iPhone or the iPad or cars or anything like that, there is nothing that the Russian economy makes at the high-tech level that is as capable as the United States. It's simply far more capable in pretty much every respect. You know, it's a major industrial power, the leading country in the world. And so given that disparity, it's not even clear that those systems are as reliable that the Russians have. But we do know from the United States that they've developed something called a burst height compensation fuse. Okay, which when a missile lands, its error, its accuracy is measured by a concept called CEP, circular error of probability. Right? What's the margin of error? How far away from the desired target can the missile land and still destroy the target? The United States has built a burst height compensation fuse, which increases the accuracy of its missiles and their warheads by a third. Okay. And this was discussed in the Bulletin of the Atomic Scientists in 2017. It's a revolutionary development because it means that effectively what the United States has as part of its modernization program is they have increased the size and lethality of their nuclear force by a third without actually doing so. Because if you can achieve the same effect through more accurate targeting, then the other side actually has less lethality. And this was something that has greatly concerned the Russians. They know about this, and it's why they have been doing things like hypersonic weapons. It's why China has been testing polar orbiting and polar transiting missiles and other hypersonic weapons that fly, that orbit the Earth, and from that point they attack. Not because it's an advanced technology, because they know that the normal way of targeting is actually not that reliable. So they've got to find a way to still try and beat the US defense systems as a deterrent. And so if you explore this idea, this new technology called the burst height compensation fuse, you'll see what it ought to be the most important story in strategic studies and in nuclear theory of the last 5 years. It's barely gotten a mention. And so all of these are in the calculations, and much of this has actually been discussed in private by the Russians, and we know this through the leaked WikiLeaks cables, the leaked State Department cables. So that's basically, I think, where it's at, that the Russia has a soft underbelly, if you look at its geography, and the countries that are NATO partners or NATO members, if there is ballistic missile defense systems there, it's not a defense system. It's an enhanced first strike system. And the idea of creating strategic space is a legitimate Russian concern, but what is not legitimate is the invasion of Ukraine, right? Well, everybody knows that there is a plausible solution available and has been on the table for many years. And that is a Ukraine that is free to join the European Union, free to integrate its economy, but has to be neutral. And this is exactly what Austria did. It was able to prosper. It was able to flourish during the Cold War, but there were no foreign bases on its soil, no missiles threatening the Soviet Union. And it was actually, its citizens were able to enjoy a good life. The thing that I don't like about the this whole idea about, you know, one side or the other cheering on the Russians or the Ukrainians is the callous disregard for the human dignity of the people who are affected by these wars.
On both sides.
Well, yes. Of course. Yes. I think there is another side to it, though, which has got nothing to do now with the leaked WikiLeaks cables, which I think is worth discussing. But it's got to do with the soft power lessons that can be learned. I'd like to hear your views on it, because I don't know what it's like in the United States. I'd like to know, you talked about NATO liberals. I'd like to know from you, Scott, as well as you, Bob, what's the atmosphere there? I mean, is it reminiscent of the 1917 war scare with Woodrow Wilson, when they took an isolationist population and they egged them on till they were really, really keen?
I'm not that old.
Bob's probably around. Bob was probably around then, not me.
Well, I mean, you know, you're a historian, and and based on your reading of American policy, I mean, my understanding of that whole thing is based only on reading rather than primary research. I mean, I'm aware of the imprisonment of Eugene Debs and everybody else.
I'm a frustrated comic at heart, so I had to. I think Scott was going to either make a comment or ask you something before we move on to this.
Okay.
Yeah, and maybe they're connected. You know, thinking about that third pillar you're talking about, where they're trying to move up the military capabilities as close as they can, going into, you know, up on the western border of Russia, and with Putin's response to that, with his reaction to that and this invasion and war, you know, what do you think is, you know, actually there was an article from Noam Chomsky a day or two ago where he commented that this was probably a very welcome gift to Washington, is what he said. And I'm just wondering what your thoughts are on, you know, what the U.S. is looking to get out of this in this particular moment. Is part of it around this, you know, being able to sort of neutralize their missile capability, or are there other pieces as well?
The principal aim is to retain forces on the European continent that preserve a division of power to prevent European integration along European lines but rather to ensure that the United States is a major player in Europe. That's been the case. Actually, it goes back to this, to the time that the United States replaced Britain as the global hegemon. There's a book by George Kennan called American Diplomacy. And if you want to have a look at it, have a look at page 5, where he says, well, Britain's geopolitical tradition is to see itself as an island off the coast of Europe. And that means they've got to make sure that no single power dominates the European continent or brings it its economy together in an integrated manner under its leadership. And so he says, if you look at that section in American Diplomacy, he says, well, we've got to learn, I'm paraphrasing, we've got to learn from this, and we must see ourselves as an island off the coast of Eurasia. Just as Britain sees itself as an island off the coast of Europe, we've got to make sure we see ourselves as an island off the coast of Eurasia, which means we have to preserve a division of power in Eurasia. We can't allow countries to integrate in an alliance, even if it's a defensive alliance, and we can't allow the European economy to be integrated under the leadership of any given power. And there's a reason for that. The European economy has got about like 450 million consumers. Their education level as a whole is higher than the United States. The level of science education as a whole is higher than the United States. The United States obviously dominates at the elite high-end level, but as a whole, taking the entire population into account. The level of healthcare is better. The level of worker protection is better, which means they're actually more competitive than the United States if they are able to integrate themselves. And they would be a major rival, and would an integrated Europe would displace the United States as the dominant power. You know, the United States population is about 330 million. And if you take the European Union and its expanding populations, that would be larger than the United States, wealthier than the United States, with a population that was better educated in science and technology, where a third of the population didn't believe in direct creation along biblical lines or in miracles. I mean, I think there's one poll that once showed that the United States actually is matched by Iran in the high proportion of its population that believes in direct divine intervention. And
miracles. Oh, it's worse. It's much higher than Iran, actually. Okay. Iranians have a much, they believe in science far more than Americans do.
Well, I mean, look, I do know that they have all kinds of crazy beliefs, and really who doesn't, you know, but I know, but the point is that the level of competitiveness.
No, my point is simply that you have no idea how we have these incredible segments in the United States who are, I mean, they're indescribable. Yeah, it's, right. it's
look, this is where I really would appreciate you telling me.
Well, I wanted to say something though, because I wanted to get back to that question you had about soft power. But I want to point out, and then we've been doing this a lot, what Joe Biden's doing today is perfectly consistent with what, you know, the NATO liberals have been doing throughout the Cold War. I mean, if you look at, you know, Truman during, let's say, the 48 war scares, just to throw that out there, after the Czech coup and the, you know, during the Greek Civil Wars. If you look at Kennedy after, especially after the missile crisis, Johnson in the Vietnam era, you know, the Gulf, the first Gulf War, the invasion of Iraq. I mean, these are all very consistent. You have these NATO liberals who are, you know, kind of going by this Cold War book. The United States, as you just pointed out, and I'm really glad you did that, really on these kind of quality of life issues like education and healthcare and things like that, is falling further behind.
Belief in science.
Yeah, all that. And so what we're pursuing is remember the old Italian right, what was it called? Constant friction or constant tension. But I think that's really the only thing the U.S. has left. It has to have this. It has this immense military infrastructure, right? 11 carriers, over 800 bases, 5,500 or so nuclear missiles. Not as many as Russia, but
well, I mean, that's where it dominates. So it dominates.
And so, but it has to maintain crises in order to be able to use that. Because in a peaceful world, I mean, look at how people freaked out when they talked about the peace dividend in '91. They had to go find new enemies and new reasons to ramp up militarization.
Noriega didn't cut it, did he?
No, that wasn't good enough. Yeah, if you could take this guy out in a monastery with Twisted Sister or Iron Maiden or whatever it was, then that's enough. And you know, that's why they went after Saddam, right? He was the new Hitler, right? And there's always a new Hitler. But what Biden's doing today and the NATO liberals are doing today is really consistent with that. And as for the question of soft power, I mean, I think we're clearly seeing that there is a very effective propaganda campaign going on. I think it's the kind of stuff Ed and Noam wrote about so intelligently, you know, decades ago now. And we're seeing it, you know, at a level that I think that would shock them, because now we have all these means of social media and, you know, we can put up, we can turn the city hall, you know, into blue and yellow Ukraine, you know, symbolic colors. And the thing, you know, as you pointed out, that the human aspect of this is, you now have this kind of, it's not like the war scare of 1917 where you're raising bonds, but it's damn close to that. Essentially, you're being encouraged to support Ukraine, which is fine. I mean, all of us have condemned Putin's invasion. That's easy to do. That's a no-brainer. But what we have now in the United States is this kind of bloodlust where people are rooting for not just like, you know, kind of an end of the war, but they're rooting for Ukraine to kind of go on this kind of military counteroffensive and eviscerate Russian troops now, which is only going to lead to immense bloodshed by a lot of different people, and not to mention the sanctions against Russia, which are going to do, you know, immense harm. And so that, I think, is the part that, like, as an American, I find kind of most stark and frightening, right? Because everybody is just sucked. I mean, a few weeks ago when this began, and Scott, you know the numbers better than me, I think it was like 26 or 28% thought the U.S. had some kind of an interest here. And the other day it was like 74% of Americans wanted a no-fly zone.
74%, yeah. With large numbers from both party identifications.
They don't know what a no-fly zone is, but they want it. Right. Yeah.
You know, it's quite interesting. One, we've been in this sort of like populist moment in this country for, you know, half a decade or whatever, well, probably longer, but half a decade where it's been very vocal and visible. And that has seems like it's completely quelled now. And like, I see we're right. There's like this media narrative around some of the kind of right-wing Republican affiliated white nationalists, like having rallies cheering on Putin. But like more often than not, it's most of them are like, we need to go help the Ukrainians. Many of the, you know, I don't know what the breakdown of this, but like 40,000 went and joined an international brigade to go fight with the Ukrainians. A number of the sort of people, just anecdotally, that I'm friends with, who are like, I would say are more liberal Democrat leaning, much more liberal than Bob or I, are like, you know, they're all about it. They're like, we need to go. They're very much hawkish liberals. It's fascinating. Look, and then some of it, I think, is manufacturing consent. Like, the media just hammers people on this all the time too.
So these are people from the United States, you say, who have some military or veteran background or are younger and are deciding to go to fight. Is that right?
Yeah.
Although not Kyle Rittenhouse. He can only kill people in the streets. So, you know.
But Iraq and Afghan vets.
Okay. Well, let me tell you if what you say is true, let me tell you what is waiting for us at the end of this decade. Those people will turn into far-right terrorists, insurgents, crime gangs, money launderers, human traffickers, because once they get into this again, if in fact people are being recruited as volunteers to go and fight a guerrilla war in Ukraine against Russia, in order to bleed Russia on its own borders, that thing could last for a decade, and it will morph. Once you take things out of the realm of nonviolence and you move things into the realm of violence, then you've lost immediately about 60% of your population, because it means that, generally speaking, it becomes masculine, a militarized masculinity comes into play. You've lost half the population, then you've lost the other half of that half, namely the older people and the kids. And so you're actually reducing your ability as a society to resist if you move away from the realm of nonviolence. As long as you stay nonviolent, it's potentially open to participation by everybody, not just the fittest, most ruthless people in the population. Once you move into the realm of violence, a violent insurgency, then what you have is extreme groups get empowered, and then it morphs into crime networks in order to fund the insurgency. And then these people will then come back into Europe, into Western Europe, and given international transport networks elsewhere in the world. And just as jihadists or people who flew in the 1990s, or even in the early 2000s, into places like Afghanistan and Iraq, morphed into terrorist networks and all kinds of other activities afterwards for the next two decades. That's what's waiting for Eastern Europe and Western Europe, if what you say is true.
And I would argue the U.S., I feel like the potential for blowback with right-wing Nazi-affiliated groups is huge. I mean, I don't know how big it is, but we definitely have a very active, vibrant white supremacist Nazi movement here. And that's who's doing a lot of the recruiting for some of these international brigades, or like the Azov brigade is like totally neo-Nazis. They fly swastikas.
Well, I'm sure that there are extremist groups on the Russian side too. It would not surprise me.
Oh, absolutely. No doubt.
Yeah, totally.
Well, no. And I say this not in order to kind of protect my right flank or left flank or anything like this.
I say this
simply as an analyst. I mean, the reality is
exactly.
Once you take things out of the realm of nonviolence, which nonviolence, of course, as far as I'm concerned, involves breaking the law, civil disobedience. It includes all of that. It's just not violent. And so once you take things out of that, like we saw in the Arab Spring or with Syria and places like that, then the most violent, most ruthless elements get emboldened. And there goes the end of the revolution or any prospect that what would come in its place is a better society. I would encourage you to at some point do a show on the way in which nonviolence actually worked in a country like East Timor, because the entire society kind of was mobilized. And what was left at the end of that, yes, Timor was destroyed, but it also became independent. But you didn't have crime gangs running around, because it was led by guerrillas, but also by the church, by nuns, by students, and it largely remained nonviolent. Now, partly it's because East Timor was in the middle of the Indonesian archipelago and had no international supporters, so it didn't have a third country that could send it weapons. But had those been in play, you'd have a much more horrible, violent, crime-ridden society than what you have now. In fact, you know, the entire Jabhat al-Nusra, the Nusra Front in Syria, which is, an al-Qaeda affiliate and a breakaway group, is because the Arab Spring and the Syrian Revolution degenerates away from nonviolent civil disobedience into a violent insurgency. And so that I think is what's down the road. In fact, what you said about the white supremacists and the whoever else they happen to be, I think it needs to be put on the record now in a publication, either in a blog post or something, just to warn what's coming. Because by the end of this decade, those people who go up idealistically to fight and defend a beleaguered country like Ukraine will not be the same people when they come back. They will develop connections and ways of seeing the world, habits of being, processes of acting that will see them turn into gangsters, assassins, mercenaries.
This is how we got filibusters and soldiers of fortune and the KKK. I mean, a lot of those groups consisted of veterans of the Mexican War, the Civil War. It's an old.
Well, what is filibuster? Sorry, what the filibuster was happening in the Senate?
No. In the 1840s, there were groups of soldiers of fortune called filibusters. Southern planters would pay, create these private armies of veterans of the Mexican War, who went into like Cuba and Nicaragua to try to overthrow the governments to create slave colonies of the United States there. But earlier you mentioned Afghanistan. Another thing that I think is recurrent we're seeing now. And again, this isn't just in like some crazy right-wing publications. This is more or less mainstream, is the idea that we, meaning the Americans, can turn Ukraine into another Afghanistan. Remember Brzezinski's famous boast that, he was behind this. He baited the Soviet Union.
Do you believe all that? Do you believe
his... I don't at all. No, I never have. But I do think it's ironic that people who do believe that totally dismiss the idea that NATO and Western encirclement is a legitimate reason for Putin to be concerned, right? But no, yeah. I don't. I think Brzezinski was bragging after the fact.
Yes, I just thought the guy would look. It seemed to me that he would write a book on foreign policy to coincide with the start of any American administration.
Yeah.
And those were, you know, revealing insight, helpful insight into the way in which a geostrategic analyst sort of saw the world. But I think at times he over-egged the pudding in order to show that, you know, he was far more brilliant or whatever, if you call that brilliance. Yeah. No, but that's what's coming. Look, the other thing, the other aspect of this is right now things are occurring in an atmosphere of optimism, idealism, and many of the people who are going to be volunteering to defend Ukraine. Perhaps they haven't got too much going on or too many hopeful things going on in their own lives in the United States or wherever else. But perhaps they also are idealistic, and they're not going to be like that you come into contact with the experience of war. But the idealism, I think, is worth noting for this reason. It demonstrates the way in which Russia and China have very, very weak ability to wield soft power. By this, I mean to control the narrative, not just what's happening, but what do people say about what's happening? What do people understand to be happening? And how do they understand the world? China's point of view, or Russia's point of view, or the United States' point of view, is not being internalized by masses of the world's population equally. In fact, one thing that China will probably have learned from all this is that Russia made huge missteps in its soft power by not constantly talking about the Donbass for the last two decades, the way in which the United States talked about places like Darfur. If you've heard about Darfur and you haven't heard about the Donbass, when Donbass has got 14,000 people dead, but Darfur has been called a genocide and things like that. It's not that Darfur was not bad. It's just that it is not widely known. And one of the lessons that the Chinese will have gotten is that they haven't prepared the ground for a takeover of Taiwan. In the mind of the public of the world, there has been a humanitarian crisis in Darfur. Donbass is almost completely unknown. And forget about Luhansk. People have no idea what the heck that is. And so the narrative that is put out, regardless of whether it happens to be credible or not, is simply not believed or even understood or heard by large sections of the world's population. The way they've heard about, say, Darfur or other places that the United States and its ideological institutions, namely the State Department and the media and many university people and think tanks, the way they've actually shown what it is that one should care about. I mean, the media can't tell people what to think, but it is extremely effective, as somebody said, in telling people what to think about. And so, if the focus of attention for the last two decades has been on places that are regarded as legitimate of human concern, these are controlled by the United States and institutions, then that's what Russia lacks. It's simply unable to defend its policy because it has not made the case effectively in the minds of the global public that it was intervening in a responsibility to protect the people of the Donbass. Whereas R2P, or the responsibility to protect, the ground for that was prepared in the late 90s. And every humanitarian intervention was portrayed as such and believed as such because the ideological institutions were operating to ensure that was the case. That is simply outside the power of Russia and China. And so one of the things we're going to see over the course of this decade is a greater focus from China on trying to portray its narrative to prepare the human terrain as much as the military terrain for a takeover of Taiwan.
But what you just said kind of reminded me that, you know, in the 60s, despite this amazing and immense propaganda machine that the United States had, the so-called third world, Latin Americans, Asians, Africans, supported the Vietnamese Revolution and the Cuban Revolution and the South African ANC and the Algerians. And I don't know, I legitimately don't know today if we're seeing something like that, where clearly the West is all in on Ukraine, but I don't know what, you know, people in these kind of subjected peripheral areas, you know, how they feel about it. And that might actually be to China's favor. But so you can speak to that also. I just kind of what, well, we can talk, we can mention that, but also just, you know, what's China's longer game here? Does it have an interest in mediating this? Should it just let both sides kind of pound each other a bit in order to kind of create its own opportunities? I mean, China, I think the U.S. is clearly the U.S.'s biggest nemesis, not Russia. And yeah, I think Americans don't understand even yet how weak China is still comparatively. There is an immense, today, even an imbalance of power, militarily at least. Yeah. And so I just wonder if you wanted to kind of speak to any of that.
Yeah, sure. I can talk about China. Look, China's goal is to restore its country to greatness, not dominance, but greatness, which means they want to ensure that the country is a middle income country throughout. And it wants to build what it calls a different type of international order, not one dominated by China, but one that is more, multipolar, let's say. That the United States remains the dominant power within its hemisphere, the Western Hemisphere, that China remains at the center of an economic and military system in East Asia, and that Western Europe, you know, ought to have its own system or Europe. But as for what China is able to do, I just want to say that China actually took very seriously the bombing of its embassy in Belgrade in May 99, and partly because it understood why the US was doing it. The Serbs had shot down an advanced American aircraft, a spy plane. And that spy plane was believed to be concealed in the Chinese embassy in Belgrade so that the Chinese could do detailed reverse engineering to work out how it worked and to build it themselves, steal the technology. And so it was believed that the reason why the United States bombed the Chinese embassy in Belgrade wasn't even an accident or whatever, but in order to stop that aircraft falling into the hands of China's engineers. Okay, so that's the sort of the basis of it. One of the things they decided to do was take a very close look at the way the United States fought wars, because China has not been in an armed conflict since 1979. It fought a border war with Vietnam. It believed it was going to win, but misjudged the logistics, because Vietnam had far more railways in the border with China than China had in its border with Vietnam. And so China lost that war, but instead of continuing to stay there, declared victory and came home. It really tried to learn from the United States. And one of the things it figured out was that in the 2003 invasion of Iraq, one of the US aircraft carriers fired 96 Tomahawk missiles in 4 minutes. A Tomahawk missile is a cruise missile, which means it has an engine of its own. It doesn't just operate according to gravity. It can actually fly like a plane. It can be reprogrammed and retargeted in flight. And so if the US aircraft carrier is able to fire 96 Tomahawk missiles from a single carrier in 4 minutes, China understands that that kind of effort would overwhelm its own coastal defenses in the event of a conflict. So much of its military modernization has been to deal with that aspect of it. What they also worked out is that the United States, its entire doctrine is based on gaining control of the air. It wants to use its ground forces and its sea forces only after it's achieved air superiority. And so what China did was it built an asymmetric doctrine. It built an integrated air and missile defense system in the south. That means, firstly, it bought Russian air defense systems, and it's called S-400, which have a range of about 300 miles, very accurate. The various missile batteries can they have fire control radars, they have wide-ranging radars, which can detect incoming U.S. aircraft, incoming U.S. missiles, incoming, all kinds of ballistic and cruise missiles, and can shoot them down. And they've got fire control radars, and they can communicate because the links between one radar battery and a missile battery and other missile batteries are buried underground. So they cannot even be jammed by U.S. cyber jamming, right? And so the military center of gravity of any conflict in the South China Sea is the air defense system in Southern China. As long as that air defense system is in place, the United States cannot gain control of the air. And if it doesn't have control of the air, it cannot win either at land or at sea. Neither it nor any army it creates in its own image is able to fight and win unless it has air control. You can see how within a week of the Bagram air base in Afghanistan being shut down, the Afghan National Army shut down. In 2014, as soon as air power was taken away, 800 ISIS fighters in pickup trucks were able to defeat a large Iraqi army, which had been trained by the United States. And as long as China is able to deny the United States air superiority, its blockade of Taiwan can continue indefinitely. So China understands that, and it's actually worked it out. It's done everything it needs to do, I believe. It's done what it needs to do to take Taiwan. It's just that the taking of Taiwan doesn't need to be by an invasion. It could be by a blockade. If the main effort is a blockade, then the US has no plan B and Taiwan has no plan B, right? That's the first thing. The other aspect of China is it wants to build an economic system. It's called the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, the SCO. And that integrates Central Asia, India, Russia, in an economic philosophy that's could be described as the flying geese. This is an economic doctrine that comes out of the 60s and the 70s, whereby the lead country in the newly industrializing Asian economies, this is the time Taiwan, South Korea, so on, one country, Japan, would have the most advanced technology. And the lower end stuff would be manufactured by the other countries. And then when it took on the next generation of cutting edge technologies, like a flying geese, the lead goose in the formation, that technology would go to the next group of countries in the back. So China is trying to get rid of its higher polluting, less advanced technology, but it wants to give that across to Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, and the Central Asian countries. And so it will then continue to be in the vanguard of the high-end technologies, and the lower-end technologies will get farmed out. And this actually turns out, as far as those countries are concerned, to be a better deal because it's getting technology for free. It's got to be part of the Chinese economic system, but it's getting technology for free. It doesn't have to go cap in hand to the World Bank or the International Monetary Fund and then surrender its sovereignty when it can't pay its debts. So that's what China wants. China wants an integrated world economy with enough developmental space for developing countries, but in a system where Chinese corporations have the advantage.
This is actually similar to the U.S. program for Japan after World War II, after October 1st, 1949. And John Dower has a couple of good books, one, Embracing Defeat, on that, where the United States envisioned Japan being this linchpin of Asian capitalism. And I actually argue that that's the origins of the Vietnam War come out of that, because yes. Vietnam is necessary to be, a place for investment, for, making small goods. Yes. And with the nationalist communist revolution, you can't do that. No. And so I think there's a story, I don't know how apocryphal it is, that when the Americans took the Japanese surrender, there was a map of the Greater East Asia co-prosperity sphere on the wall, and the Japanese commander said, well, we failed. Let's see how well you do. So,
yes. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, this is the reverse course, right? I mean, initially, it was right. Chiang Kai-shek's China that was going to be the center of the reconstruction of capitalism in East Asia. Right. But after as you said, the 1st of October 49, when the nationalists lost and the communists won, that was all changed in a reverse course, and China would be isolated and Japan would be reconstructed, along with the emperor system would be preserved. But this is a different kind of world, of course, because there was a lot of potential real growth possible, high carbon, not very good for the environment, but it was genuine real growth possible with expanded manufacturing, more jobs and things like that. The growth that's been in place essentially since the last 40 years of the neoliberal assault on the population has actually involved low growth and a lot of funny money that's come in since 2008. I mean, that's really what is at the scene. There is a really weak foundations of industrial capitalism now, with the increasing amounts of quantitative easing, with the Fed printing more and more money. And I just want to read out something from a book that I've just finished reading. It's by Christopher Leonard, And just give me a second. Okay, so Christopher Lennon's new book, The Lords of Easy Money, he says that in the first century of its existence, the US Federal Reserve expanded the monetary base to about $900 billion US, right? So that it took about 100 years to print about $1 trillion, round figures. But after 2008, this is the 2008 crisis, between 2008 and 2014, it printed $3.5 trillion. So that means the Fed printed 3.5 centuries worth of money in a few years. And after COVID, it printed the same amount, $3 trillion, in a few months. And so all those years of economic policy that flooded the financial system made the US economy and the other economies connected to it more fragile and unfair. I mean, it benefited portfolio investors like BlackRock and Vanguard because it meant they were able to buy into the stock exchanges of other countries. But the economy as a whole remains stagnant and fragile and weak. And so that's not really the basis on which one can reconstruct and promise a better life or a better future for people. And you know, the austerity programs and the atomization of the population, I think, is also partly responsible, in my view, for some of the irrational behavior and the antisocial behavior that we are seeing. We've been seeing over the last 5 years.
Do you anticipate? I'm sorry, Scott. Go ahead.
Ask your China question.
I was going to say, do you anticipate China at some point kind of playing some kind of mediating role here or just kind of waiting it out?
I think China will wait it out because if you look at it, they don't want to be too closely associated with wars. I mean, China has a policy of respecting country sovereignty, and what Russia did was illegal. It's a violation of the United Nations Charter. And so China can't be seen to be too close to it. I believe because of China's influence, Russia has pulled its punches. You know, we have not seen a complete shutdown of Ukraine's electricity system or its internet or its food distribution systems via cyber warfare. Russia has actually withheld its more cutting edge assets from the war. Also, for the first week and a half, it actually wasn't fighting at night. Its aircraft were capable of fighting at night, not as capable as the United States, but it was capable, but they decided not to in order to avoid civilian casualties. And so the full range of the shock and awe and everything else has not been unleashed. And so what Russia really wants, I think, is just a squeeze, and China will come in if needed, but I think it's trying to disassociate itself and it would like the whole thing to go away, frankly. It's also more concerned about the effect of the war on economic stability around the world. And I think we should be talking about that.
Go ahead.
Okay.
I was actually going to ask you a question about the dollar, but why don't you do that first?
Okay. Oh, well, go for the dollar.
This is kind of, esoteric, but, and I actually think people are ahead of themselves because I've been reading these kinds of prophecies since November of 1967, when the British devalued the pound. But, again, we're kind of seeing these kind of, especially lefty economic types, say that this is going to be the end of American dollar hegemony. And I'm always reluctant on
that's
that.
Nonsense. Nonsense.
That's what
it's
I think.
Utter nonsense. The United States is still, 66% of US dollars are still held overseas, not in the United States.
Right. Right.
85% of contracts for the most heavily traded commodity in the world, namely oil, are denominated. The contracts are denominated.
And Russia is still selling $700 million of oil every day?
Yep. Those contracts are denominated in oil, in dollars. It's not that I reject it as a possibility in principle. It's just that the evidence is that as long as two-thirds of every US dollar printed in existence is not actually been transacted in the United States, I just don't see the dollar kind of disappearing or even not being less powerful.
A lot of American leftists are kind of hoping for some kind of Hail Mary, which often leads them to take very bizarre positions as well.
Yeah, this Hail Mary business, I think, is reflects the organizational weakness. And if you don't mind me indulging me in a kind of kind of a digression. I watched a movie a few years ago. It's been a long time since I watched a movie. It was called Avatar. I was told to go watch it because it was supposed to be a cutting edge film. It was about people who looked like the blue colored organisms who were fighting guerrilla war against settler colonialists or something like that. Well, that movie ends with nature itself expelling the colonizers. Okay, that's not the way to understand politics. Nature is not going to solve it for you. Organization is what solves it. Not belief in the environmental calamity as the way to solve the problem of imperial capitalism.
And just let me cut in. In 1983, George Frost Kennan wrote a piece in the New York Times in which he said, and this is the time during Reagan's buildup, where he said that nuclear escalation is not the gravest crisis facing the world. It's some kind of cataclysmic climate crisis. So,
I guess
Kennan is on the side of who was it, James Cameron or whoever made that movie. So,
right. Yeah. But the point is in that film Avatar, I haven't seen it.
I don't know. I haven't seen it.
Well, so. I think you should watch it for this reason. It is impossible to watch the film and not think of Indochina.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Impossible.
Oh, okay. Absolutely.
To watch that film and not think about the air war in Laos. The reaction of the peasants. But then what happens is the reason these guys win, the insurgents win, is that the trees, the animals, the weather, everything else comes in and expels the settler colonizers or the imperial forces. And really, that is escapism, because climate change is not going to kind of end imperialism. It's going to ensure that imperialism is conducted within a system.
Well, the victims of it are going to be the subject of the empire. Obviously,
it's going to be another thing in which rich capitalists can make money off of.
The first world already benefits immensely from global warming, and it's going to continue to do that. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, so this is what I want to say about the climate and the effect of the war. This is what China's looking at, and this is what we should all be looking at. And that is that you mentioned the Ukraine flag. I'm not on social media. I used to be in the early 2000s, but I'm not anymore.
Oh, it's everywhere in the United States. Everybody in the United States. It's like. In 2020, everybody had Black Lives Matters, banners up, and, everybody had tied yellow ribbon. What was that? The Iran hostage crisis. Americans are really big on symbolism. With social media, it's compounded. Everybody has the Ukrainian flag is now a profile on Facebook or Twitter. And, all the cities are at night, they're lighting up the city hall in the colors of the Ukrainian flag, and people are raising money.
Bob,
what's that?
And Scott, what's the flag of the Democratic Republic of Congo look like? This is what I mean by soft power.
Of course. What's the flag of Palestine look like? What's flag of Yemen look like? What's flag of Somalia look like?
Yep.
Right.
Yep.
My contrarian leftist friends have them putting the Palestinian flags on their Facebook pictures.
Though. Well,
I could pick Cuba and Palestine out of a lineup. The rest, I'm not so sure about.
Let's talk about the Ukraine flag, because this actually is quite important for geopolitics. Okay, the flag is blue over yellow, and it is done explicitly to denote a flat wheat field underneath an azure sky. The blue sky over a wheat field, that is explicitly what it's supposed to connote. And that is because Ukraine is called the breadbasket of Europe. It's a major transit country of Russian gas, but more important than that, it is the fifth largest producer of wheat, exporter of wheat. Russia, which produces, let's say, 20% of the world's wheat. So basically, for every 5 grains of wheat, on average, one is Russian, right? And maybe the second is Ukrainian. Mm-hmm. This war disrupts Russia's wheat exports around the world, or at least it makes the price of commodities like grain, like oilseed, like bread, sugar, maize, higher. Now, that's actually how the Arab Spring was triggered. It was triggered in part by food inflation, right? Egypt, in fact, still gets the bulk of its wheat from Russia and Ukraine because it's converted its agricultural resources on the Nile to produce cotton. I mean, this is the doctrine of comparative advantage. It's not supposed to be self-sufficient, despite having the world's, one of the largest rivers in the world and food sufficiency. It's actually designed to produce cotton so that other people can make cloth, and you know, high-end kind of fashion. And so wheat prices are, you know, 25% higher this year than they were last year. Fertilizers, which Russia makes a lot of, fertilizer prices are going to be higher. It's going to be increased because demand is going to be less. Natural gas is going to increase the price of that, and that's a key component in fertilizers. So the shock effects of this in terms of hunger around the world and instability, and more and more people are marching in the streets at precisely the time when the global South has gone into debt in order to cope with COVID and to provide for their people, that the ripple effects, the disorder that's coming, I think is a major story this decade. There are two things we've talked about in your program that I think are going to be validated for the next, you know, 10 years from now. And perhaps it should be, you should archive it in a way that it can be accessed or at least highlighted. One is the neo-Nazi / criminal gangs that will plague Europe at the end of the decade. And the other one is this whole decade is going to result in greater instability in our peoples and governments being overthrown in the global South because of the increasing cost of wheat and fertilizer, which are essential. The most important human rights organizations in the world have declared this is the case. I'm not referring to Human Rights Watch or Amnesty International. I'm referring to the really most important human rights organizations in the world, the World Food Program and the Food and Agriculture Organization. These are missing from the debate in Australia. If you ask an Australian, well, what's the human rights organizations? If they have an answer, the answer would be Amnesty or Human Rights Watch. But in fact, if you're looking at the human rights of the majority of the world's 7 billion people, we're talking about the Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations and the World Food Program. Well, they're already reporting the prices of everything is increasing, that there are taxes you know, to curb consumption, but because supply is less, then the price goes even higher. Fertilizers are more. And given the fact that on average, if somebody were to visit the planet Earth from a foreign planet, they would say the typical Earthling is a peasant. That's where actually people are. And they need fertilizers. Well, if natural gas is a major component of fertilizer, and the price of natural gas is soaring, then fertilizers become expensive, and the price of wheat becomes expensive. And then you have the inability of governments to cope, and the Washington consensus of austerity, of the privatization of state assets, of the financialization of the economy, is simply unable to cope in this decade. But the China model could help them. And so this is the broader realignment that's going on. Sorry, I'll
well,
stop.
I believe just a couple of days ago, I think it was in Egypt, I read that there were food protests there already because of the price of grains.
Is that so right? I've been very busy teaching. I believe it was in Egypt,
but they're already, you're already seeing, you know, these kind of popular protests against the price of grains, the price of fertilizer. And that's only, you know, the longer this continues, and I think it's going to continue for quite some time, obviously that's going to get worse. And obviously the people who live in precarity globally are going to be you know, the people who are affected by it. So.
Hey, the other thing I would say from the sort of like shock perspective of like what we'll see, which will be a problem in a decade and decades to come, is, you know, the energy sector is actually using this opportunity, disruption of oil and gas into Europe from Russia, that sort of thing, where there's been some progress on climate emissions and things like that. They're going to use this to like lock in the more fossil fuels. They're putting here in the US, they're putting more export. There's, you know, lots of projects where they're trying to like make more export capacity on the Gulf of Mexico and things like that, where those projects have been defeated. They're putting those back on the table. I would say a similar thing could probably happen with nuclear. I just think it's also going to lock in a lot of the dangerous energy sources that we've been fighting for a long time as a result of this as well.
Yes. I mean, but the thing is, though, you know, do policymakers know about the longer term effects of the things you and I have been talking about, Scott? You know,
well, here they don't even believe in it. Many of them don't even believe in the long-term effects. So
yeah, they, you know, we used to believe that people in Congress, let's say, or state legislators, you know, they had this ideological predisposition, but they weren't idiots. They were just kind of playing to the rubes, right? That's not the case anymore. They are profoundly ignorant and stupid and racist and reactionary in ways that even 10 years ago, I would have found unimaginable. They are who they are. It's not like Marjorie Taylor Greene and Boebert. I mean, that's not an act. Matt Gaetz and Jim Jordan, those are not circus performers. They're real, and it's chilling.
Well, look, can I ask you guys, each of you, please, to just talk about what's going on in your country as we come up to the midterm elections in November? How do you see the elections playing out, given the electoral, the laws that are trying to be coming in are being suppressed at times? Because, you know, is the United States heading for proto-fascism by the 2024 presidential elections? That's what I want to know. What do you think?
I don't like throwing the word fascism around. I think it's too
easy. Okay,
and
look, let's call it neo-authoritarianism, because it's basically minority rule.
It's going to be a bloodbath for the Democratic Party. I don't see how they can avoid that short of something bizarre happening. They are, I don't know if you're familiar with the Globetrotters that well, the Harlem Globetrotters, but the Democrats are the Washington Generals of politics. That's the team that is always they play against the Globetrotters, and their role is to lose every game, right? And that's the Democratic Party, no matter
hang on how a second. Good things look. I know about the Harlem Globetrotters. I've never seen a game because I don't really care for basketball or anything like that. But you mean to say it's actually fixed?
Well, it's a celebrity thing. They go around. It's entertainment. It's like a circus. It's not a real basketball. I mean, it's a real basketball team, but it's not like a league.
They're supposed to lose, are they?
They play all over the world.
Yeah.
And the Washington Generals are their opponent every game. And they're
drawn. And they're supposed to lose.
Every game. They let them win one time a year.
Yeah. And their job is to lose to the Globetrotters, no matter what. Right. And the Democratic Party, I mean, after January 6th, 2021, I mean, in a sane world, the Republican Party would have probably disbanded. Right. They had organized and conducted an attack, a riot in the national capital. And yet, no, there's been no repercussions. No one politically has been touched. You know, people like the senator here in Texas, Ted Cruz or Hawley, nothing's happened to any of them. And, you know, in all the polling, the Republicans are seen as like more responsible, better on the economy, better. It's absolutely stunning. And I mean, we can talk a lot about how bad Americans are and how bad our education system is. But at some point, the Democratic Party needs to own this. They are utterly beyond any kind of description, you know, incompetent. And it will lead to some.
But then explain to me, could you explain to me then how you see that particular political alignment in the United States reacting to Central Asia and parts of Eurasia integrating themselves into a Chinese-led economic sphere? How would they react to this?
Scott, yeah, I've been talking too much.
I mean, some of their talking points is it's very anti-China. It was like a big thing with Trump. And so, I mean, I think they're going to be very isolationist on that. I think that there's a big component of the Republican Party, which is like the far right, the Trump right, very isolationist, which, you know,
they're also anti-NATO and anti-interventionist in a lot of ways too. So.
That's true. There's a big racist element, and anti-Asian racism is a big part of that. And so I sometimes go back and forth about how much power they wield versus how much media attention they get. But I do think that faction, whether it's 20 million people or 200 million people, are going to be like, you know, very much opposed to that sort of thing. That's what's been interesting about what we're seeing with this, you know, the sort of pro-Ukrainian message that we're seeing in the US media is like so many people have like turned. It's amazing how much the manufactured consent actually has wields power over that. And that far right has its own media sphere, which like we don't watch. We see clips of it and laugh at it, but you know, they also have a lot of power. Tucker Carlson, Fox News, all of those folks.
And there are elements that are still, even now, still very much pro Putin, and they, you know, they have cheers going for him and everything else.
I'll just give an example of how we have it here. In Australia, every election must occur on a Saturday between 8 a.m. and 6 p.m. Never on a weekday and never outside those hours of 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. on a Saturday. This is whether it's a state election, a federal election, any kind of election. And they are always held in certain pre-designated areas like primary schools and things like that. It's a community event, people, you know, offering sausage sizzles and all kinds of other things. Now,
they have outlawed giving water to people vote waiting in line to vote in certain states.
They've outlawed giving what?
Water.
Food and water. In the state of Georgia.
In Texas or Georgia, when it's 100 degrees, you're not allowed to give somebody a bottle of water.
While they're waiting in line to vote.
Yeah.
Really?
You think we can make that up?
Look,
it would take Gore Vidal and Hunter Thompson on like the biggest acid trip ever to make this shit up, man.
Okay, well, look, just so you understand what happens here, it's the Electoral Commission conducts elections according to a certain way, and it's not affected by the way the legislation of the legislative bodies, parliament and so on, you know, that they don't actually have any control. They put in place a system which is agreed on, and then the electoral authority kind of runs it. And it's neutral, it's highly respected. And then it's a community environment with all kinds of facilities like sausages and water or, you know, whatever else, soft drinks, tea, coffee. Provided by community people, anybody, while people are staying in line. And of course, in Australia, voting is compulsory. And so you can be fined if you don't vote and you haven't got a good reason for it. And the reasons why you'd be exempted are themselves withheld from the public. So people can't simply draw on reasons and say, well, I'm offering you this reason. So basically, there's a high degree of public support for compulsory voting, along with the general annoyance on the actual day of voting. But if the United States were to be admitted into the Australian Federation, let us say hypothetically, it would not be allowed. In fact, there was a study that showed that the United States would not be allowed into the European Union because its electoral system, its voting system, is not democratic. The very idea that you can have an election on a weekday and thereby deny working people, especially the gig economy, the opportunity to vote would be intolerable in this country. It has to happen on a Saturday between 8 a.m. and 6 p.m.
Yep. Quick question, a little bit of a tangent. You know, I know that there's an election that may be called, it has to be called before May for prime minister.
Yes.
And I'm wondering, you know, what you think his prospects are, particularly in light of security issues happening right now globally. Right.
The election hasn't been announced. The election is very likely to be to occur on the 14th of May. Under our laws, when the Prime Minister calls an election, there is a minimum of 33 days between issuing the writs that's calling the election and holding the election. So let's take a round figure 35, that's 5 weeks. Which means when the election is called, it'll probably be in early April or late March, so towards the end of this month. The government is behind in the polls, but not decisively so. The prime minister or the government, the political party in power, led by the prime minister himself, are very weak in polling numbers of women between 25 and 55. And from 35 to 55, they are even worse. I saw that expression on your face, Bob. We are referring to political opinions of women and how they think of prime ministers.
You're going to get me in trouble.
The point being, I don't see how he can compensate for that. They just don't have that demographic under control. So what they're trying to do is fight a khaki election. Or khaki, as you call it, a khaki election. So a khaki election by highlighting everything that is occurring in Ukraine as though it's occurring, you know, in the center of Australia. Any time a Chinese ship passes in international waters or Australia's exclusive economic zone, if there's any tensions as there was recently, it'll be front page news and the defense minister will call a press conference because the core point is what we said earlier, that the media are not effective in telling you what to think, but they are stunningly effective in telling you what to think about. And salience is the issue in winning an election. Every issue is not there. Every topic doesn't come up to decide an election. The question is issue salience. What's the core issue? And if they can frame the core issue as national security, then it's quite possible that the government will be returned. in the lower house. But that said, I'm not going to sort of hedge my bets. It looks like the Labour Party will win at least in the lower house. They'll have to get the numbers in the Senate in order to have their legislation through. However, if there is a if the government's polling numbers recover among women aged 25 or 35 to 55, which is very unlikely, the government will also be returned. And if they manage to actually make it a khaki election, then yes, the government will be returned.
If Labour does win, though, oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
If Labour does win, is there any reason to think they would, you know, be different on these particular issues, on these you know,
they'll be better on climate change, on
no, but I mean in terms of like Ukraine and submarine sales and all that.
Let me tell you now what the plan is, and it's bipartisan. It is in the opposition leader's national security strategy, which he announced 2 days ago. Okay, and it's reflected in the statements made by the government as well. The Australian Defence Force is going to increase its size by 2040 and even sooner. The size of the army is going to increase by a third. And what they haven't told the public is what I'm telling you now. The war planners have already worked out that a war that is started or that occurs in the South China Sea will not end there. The Chinese rational response to a war in the South China Sea is to encourage North Korea to attack South Korea. And this would force the United States to defend South Korea, which it's committed to, on land across a very, very long logistics tail across the Pacific Ocean. And so Australia will be fighting in South Korea. It'll be fighting on the Korean Peninsula by the end of this decade or by sometime next decade. And the buildup of the army is not done just for a khaki election. That's agreed on by the opposition leader, announced by the government. And if the opposition leader becomes the prime minister, then Australia is planning, is gearing up its armed forces to fight a conventional high intensity war on the Korean Peninsula. That simply cannot be told to the Australian public, but that's where we're heading. Keep this in mind, because the war game has already occurred. And they know that a war that begins in the Spratly Islands will end in Busan.
That's good to hear.
On that happy note.
We've held you for a long time, and we could talk for another 3 hours, but I know that you're busy. And
I did have one final question for you.
I'm sorry, sure.
Sure, I have 25 minutes if you want to talk. Yeah.
Yeah. My final question is that last year we talked to you about your legal case around the records around Chile and Chilean coup. And I'm wondering if you wanted to give us just a quick update or anything
okay.
on that.
Well, the case is kind of terminated now because we were able to confirm at the Administrative Appeals Tribunal that the government, when the government handed up several of its records, 700 pages of its records, some of them blacked out. The Australian Secret Intelligence Service, at the behest of the CIA, set up a station in Santiago, Chile. They spied on the government, ran agents for the CIA, acted as a conduit between the coup plotters in 73 and the CIA. We have the details of the safe house they got, the car they bought. We even have the combination number of the safe that they bought to put in that safe house. What we weren't able to get from the government at that part of the proceedings was further details and things we don't really want to know, like the identity of the agents. I couldn't care less about all that. But to get more information, I would have to go to the Federal Court of Australia. And the difference between the Federal Court of Australia and the Administrative Appeals Tribunal is that the Administrative Appeals Tribunal is within the executive branch of government. And so I carry my own costs. If I were to lose at the AAT, then I only pay my costs, not the government's. But if I go to the Federal Court and I win, then of course I get the documents, I get everything. But if I lose there, then I have to pay for the government's lawyers and everything else, which means there's no way that I'm ever going to go to the Federal Court. So the accounting I've just given you about what Australia actually did to overthrow Allende, destroy Chilean democracy, is probably the most we're going to see until the government itself decides to declassify. The important point about this, though, is not the details about who did what in Chile or which agent did what. the most important thing about it is that the same Australian government that sent military forces to Vietnam to destroy social transformation there sent its secret intelligence service, its spy agency, to Chile to destroy social transformation there, because the resources of a region have to be made available to private investors in the manner they desire. This is the idea of comparative advantage. It is the imperial component of, it is the economic component of imperialism.
And still something that even within the hallowed halls of American academia, one does not talk about without repercussions, unfortunately.
Right.
One last thing, since you have a couple minutes, and this is because we are all experts, right? And we are supposed to have some kind of predictive abilities. And I just wondered, I mean, basically what I see is just a big slog and a lot more people, you know, being hurt and dying and in Ukraine with, you know, the attendant economic issues, you know, involved in the sanctions or inflation here at home. I don't see anything, you know, positive coming out of this. I just wondered, you know, where you see things going.
The idea of Ukrainian neutrality that the Ukrainian president's been finally agreeing to talk about, I think that's where it'll end. That there will not be NATO forces in Ukraine. I mean, that is something that is the bottom line of Russia.
Oh yeah.
That's their war objective. If they can prevent NATO forces in their near abroad, as they say, then they've achieved their mission. They don't actually want to take over Ukraine. You know, they don't want to kind of annex Ukraine.
That's an immense task.
That's not the way they understand it. They understand Belarus and Ukraine and Russia as somehow belonging to some common heritage,
right,
whilst retaining you know, political independence, except that you can't bring in a hostile military alliance to the border. But where this is going to get complicated,
you sound like a tanky now. That was actually the issue in 1950. We'll talk about that at some other point. Anyway,
you know who the tankies are? The tankies are the
people. I'm kind of one, so be careful. So.
Well, the tankies are the people that actually applaud tanks going into other countries. So if you have no problem with the invasion of Iraq, which use tanks?
No, I think Hungary in
1956. Then you're a tanky.
Yeah, I think Hungary in 1956, there were the kind of concerns you just enunciated were actually present in Hungary in 1956. Well, once Nog talked about joining NATO, the tanks were coming in. But anyway.
Well, I mean, Russia is not the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union was basically trying to preserve its own empire in a way.
Yeah.
Right. Russia, basically, the current leaders of Russia represent four factions. Okay. There are the liberal reformers. So these are the people who in the 1990s came out of the party called Yabloko, Yabloko, the Yabloko party. So the liberals are one faction. You know, there's a lot of internal differences between them, but broadly speaking, they are the ones that support, you know, liberalization of both political and economic. There are the traditionalists, those who believe that there is no need to try and integrate into Europe. We have our own traditional culture. We are Russian. We are neither Asian nor European. We are Russian. And the Russian Orthodox Church is our church. We have our own traditions, our own history. We have a unique civilization. And that the role of the Russian state should be to foster Russian traditionalism. It is a kind of cultural conservatism. That is the second current in Russian political thought, right? The third current is what's called the Ordovichi Siloviki, the S-I-L-O-V-I-K-I. This is the security guardians. That's the national security people. This crisis has empowered them. That's the third thing. And the fourth one are those who actually believe in a kind of a pan-Eurasian integration. So you've got the liberals, who are kind of liberal reformers. You've got the traditionalists. You've got the pan-Europeans, and you've got the guardians, the security guardian faction. And neither of them is actually trying to recreate the Soviet Union. It's not that kind of society anymore. Yeah. You know, and so the relationship between that and the Soviet Union's own internal repression, I think, is drawing a long bow.
And to clarify, my point was simply that just like, you know, the Soviet Union in 1956, I think Putin's claims that NATO is a threat, a hostile act, should be taken seriously. I'm not justifying anything.
Let me give an example then, Scott and Bob. If our intelligence in Australia were to detect that an airfield anywhere in the Indonesian archipelago is being lengthened by 500 meters, we would have a conversation with the Indonesian ambassador. Okay, because if you lengthen an airfield in Indonesia by 500 meters, you increase the size and range of aircraft that can take off from there, which means we plan for the other side's capabilities, not uh-huh. their intentions. And so it's not actually tankiness or anything like that. It is just normal strategic planning.
It's a Cuban missile crisis, right? You see, yeah. You get some aerial photos and all of a sudden you're yeah. risking a nuclear exchange with the Soviet Union.
Yeah, look, the sad part of it is that in the minds of many Ukrainians, what they actually wanted was peace. And they actually thought, this is the people in the Galicia area of Ukraine, this is the northwestern part of Ukraine, which is the more westernized pro-European, pro-NATO part. In that area of Ukraine, they genuinely believed that the way to peace was to join NATO.
Yeah.
Because they lack strategic empathy, you see. They weren't able to understand that this was actually going to cause problems. I mean, there genuinely was the belief that, look, all we're trying to do is be defensive. Anyway, the more significant point is not Ukraine's current travails, but the prices of everything else that's going to cause instability in the global south around the world, as well as the difficulties with crime gangs and warlords yeah. developing in Europe.
Well, and also you asked about the elections earlier, and one thing, you know, because people are creating this like wag the dog scenario for Biden, he's doing this to improve his election. However, if you look at data, polling data, by an overwhelming margin, most Americans think inflation in the economy is the worst problem the U.S. faces right now. And so Biden, by taking this really hard line on Ukraine, and by the way, I'm not sure the U.S. is going to negotiate anytime soon, be willing to negotiate anytime soon, or NATO. But my point is, by taking this hard line, he's probably making inflation much worse, which is going to hurt his own election prospects. So I'm not really sure what the end game was on the U.S. side either, because everybody saw this coming for a long, long time. I'm not brilliant. I just, you know, I know a little bit. And,
yeah.
No, this is nothing. Nothing here surprises me at all.
No, but the way the policy works, I think there's in general, not this particular policy. I don't know what's in the mind of the policymakers, but I think the evidence that we've seen over the years is that policy is made to achieve certain immediate objectives, and then the can is then kicked down the road, so that the next government handles whatever problems come out of the policy, and so. If you want to establish a military base in the heart of the Middle East's oil-rich areas, namely the invasion of Iraq, the next government's problem is to deal with whatever happens from that. Mm. And so there is the normal process is that planning, you know, at least in a democratic society with changing political parties and so on, is that direction is set for the particular term of the administration. And then any problems that come about as a result of that, kind of kick down the road, and then the next person's going to deal with that.
Every time I talk to you, it's like a seminar. You are so important to me intellectually as well as a comrade, and I've learned so much from you. So thanks for talking.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. I mean, I'm like I said, I'm with Green and Red. What's next? I can get to sing with Sinatra.
We're like Sinatra.
We both open for Chomsky, right? So we've done that. So
we're like the Rat Pack of the left wing podcast.
Yeah, I mean, once you've opened for Chomsky, what's left, right?
Yeah.
So maybe do a duet with Bob Dylan or something like that.
Maybe at some point we should have a podcast in a few months' time on the democratic, equitable international order, because. What's being proposed at the United Nations since September 2011? It's never been reported even once in the United States media. I checked. Among the major organs, the phrase democratic equitable international order has never been discussed. Right? That's the alternative to the rules-based imperial order. And perhaps we can say that there is hope. There are alternatives. It's not either Putin and Xi Jinping or the US empire, but rather there is a possibility for democratic and equitable international order, which I think should be discussed.
You know, I always tell Scott, when you and I talk, we talk for about this long, and these are our conversations. This is yeah. just typical. So
yeah.
It is. I've learned so much, and can't wait to talk to you again.
Thank you for the opportunity. Okay,
folks, you've been listening to Professor Clinton Fernandes. We've been talking about Russia, Ukraine, and many, many other things. If you want to continue to check us out, go to Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. If you're watching us on YouTube, hit that subscribe button. And if you want to make a donation, go to greenredpodcast.org, hit that support button. And then also, if you want to become a patron, go to patreon.com/greenredpodcast. Clinton, it's been
also
great having
you. Rate and review and leave some comments, because that's important for algorithms. So yep. We appreciate all your support.
Yep. Everybody take care out there. Misbehave.
Thank you, Scott. Bob, bye-bye.
Bye.
The Eastern world, it is exploding, violence flaring, bullets loading. You're old enough to kill, but not for voting. You don't believe in war, but what's that gun you're toting? And even the Jordan River has bodies floating. And you tell me over and over and over again, my friend, destruction. Don't you understand what I'm trying to say? Can't you feel the fears that I'm feeling today? If the button is pushed, there's no running away. There'd be no one to save with the world in a grave. Take a look around you, boy. It's not to scare you, boy. Tell me over and over and over again, my friend. You don't believe we're on the eve of destruction. Destruction.